Okay, welcome to IT Idiots episode 34. My name's Nicholas Hill. And I'm joined by Nikki Curtis.
Hello.
Did you just burn yourself with some tea?
No, I just wasn't really... Well, I like the way you waited for me to take a swig of tea before you started.
Well, I don't know. I've been waiting hours for you.
C-Face said you make me look unprofessional in these podcasts, you know.
I make you look unprofessional? Yeah. Is that what C-Face said?
I think it's a reference to the pants scene.
I think it's a reference to the fact that she obviously loves you.
I think not. You were after anyway.
It's outrageous. You take that back. It's all our viewers who were interested in having Soufay. I mean, interested in Soufay. Right, okay, so episode 34. This week we're going to look at DOD.
Yeah.
Department of Defence.
Well, we had some forum posts from Big Lee, one of our oldest viewers, and he posts quite a lot, so we like Big Lee. And he wanted to do the OSI model. And I would have loved to have done the OSI model, to be honest, but I needed a bit of time to prepare for that. But I thought what we could do in lead up to doing OSI model is go
OSI,
through...
OSI? Was that the kind of stuff we covered like a kid at university?
You did it at university, Nick. You did the networking model. I did nothing doing networking at university.
Ah, okay.
I sort of felt. So you should know all about the OSI model.
Yeah. I've had... It's so old now. I've moved on from that to something new.
I sort of learned the OSI model a long time ago, passed my exams and sort of forgot about it.
Yeah.
But since then, knowledge of the OSI model is useful, certainly, but the Definitely. DOD model, I think, is probably a bit more useful practically, because it's actually a model that's been implemented.
It's got real-world implementation and...
Whereas the OSI reference model is just theoretical based, it's a blueprint model.
Okay. Well, that sounds quite good.
That's good. So,
yeah.
Do you wrap up that?
No, I think we've actually got to do it now.
Oh, okay. Right, so I don't know how I'm going to start on this one. So what I've got is just a few diagrams I've downloaded from the interweb.
You told me you drew that.
I did, and I uploaded it.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And what we can see in the DOD model, what are these models, what are they about? Well, we can see it's got seven layers in the OSI model anyway. The DOD model, the one that we're going to pay closer attention to today, has actually got four layers, but it's heavily mapped to TCP/IP. And some people actually refer to it as the TCP/IP model, the ARPANET model, or, you know, anything like that. So we're just going to refer to it as the DOD model.
Okay. Well, what does DOD mean?
It stands for Department of Defence.
It is the Department of Defence.
It is the Department of Defence, yeah.
Okay, well, it's just being
originally
silly.
Designed TCP/IP, I believe. You must know the history of the internet story.
Ah, vaguely.
Yeah, it's something about nuclear wars and networks being able to...
I've heard so many stories as to who invented what and...
Yeah, it's basically...
That was ARPANET.
Yeah, I think so. It's an event of... of a nuclear war, you can still get the latest episode of 24. That's okay. originally what it was.
They realised that in the event of war, there was going to be a lot of widespread panic. But as long as people still get their television,
24, yeah,
then there's going to be hysteria and madness.
Okay, so the OSI model. Just to start with, we can see it's seven layered. At the top, we've got application. At the bottom, we've got physical.
Yeah.
Now you can kind of think about this. We're sitting up at the top of the layer. The network card's sitting down at the bottom.
Yeah.
Okay, and this is a model which developers could use or someone who's designing new protocols could use and say, well, my part, i.e. the web browser, just sits in the application layer. Therefore, all I need to do is deal with the next layer down.
Yep.
Okay, so for a development point of view, they don't need to worry about what's going on in the physical layer, the data link layer, the network layer, or anything like that. You can just interface with the next one down. So that's a huge benefit in the OSI model. Each layer only needs to communicate with the layer above and the layer below. And that's true of the DOD model as well.
Yeah, okay.
So the application layer on the OSI model, you can probably guess what sits up there or what would sit up there would be things like Internet Explorer, things like that. Now the presentation layer, this is something I do sort of remember from... I think it was a networking technologies exam, Microsoft exam anyway. And for example, if we're talking between an Intel machine and a Motorola machine, the way they order their bytes is slightly different. Okay, one's least significant to most significant, and one's most to least.
Big end, little end.
You think of it how where you want it. Okay, so we can see if with this OSI model we were talking from an Intel machine, it comes... Intel Explorer chucks this information down and goes all the way down here onto the network, comes back up the Macintosh machine, and the presentation layer will bit flip that. If that's the right word, I think that's the right word. But as I say, I'm not by no means an expert on OSI.
So there must be lots of different presentations and...
Yeah.
Yep, sounds good.
Okay, so...
I won't ask questions.
Can't answer it anyway. So anyway, let's forget about OSI and go about DOD, the DOD model, because I think that's the usual.
Stay somewhere nice and safe.
Okay, now before we do that, let's just give... Because some of you guys might be taking exams, and I've got some handy things you can use to remember the seven layers of the OSI and the four layers of the DOD. So this OSI model has got seven layers.
So Richard of York gave battle in vain?
No, that's the rainbow.
Ah, yes. I knew it was there was some way of remembering something.
Now, the one I remember is all people seem to need data processing. I can't spell that. So from the top, we have application, and then we have presentation.
I was kind of right. Richard of York would need his data processing.
Session. Shut up. Transport.
Network.
Network. What's next?
Data.
Data link. And physical. Okay, so that's your OSI model. Now, the DoD model we're going to look at, you can remember there's an acronym that says people are...
friggin' stupid.
Hard to handle in new activities. Now, what are you going to say, Nick? You're going to say DoD model's got 9 layers now. That's what you're going to say. Okay, so this one's not as clean as the first one, but the first layer of the DoD model is process, stroke application. Okay, so that's the people are. The next layer down is hard to handle, host to host.
In, which is your hard to handle.
Yep. And next one in, internet.
Internet, yeah.
And next one down is network access.
Ah, okay.
So because it's actually been implemented, if we look at the top layer, process application, the kind of things that will be operating in the upper layer, process application, will be Internet Explorer and your web browser. Sorry, that is the same, isn't it? And your web server. Okay. Next one down, host to host. Deals with how we're going to get that information from source to destination.
Okay.
And we're going to this in a bit more depth, but host to host, we're looking at the connection type we're going to make between the source and the destination.
Right.
Okay, so we've got connectionless and connection orientated. Internet is the routing layer. Deals with what routers we need to cross or what's the next hop address we need to go to in order to get to the final destination.
Sorry, I was just...
get out your final destination. And the last one is network access, is how we're going to put that information on the wire. Okay, so the things living on the network access layer will be things like Ethernet, token ring, blah, 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 that kind of thing. You're about to ask something there?
Well, no, earlier on when you came round and mentioned about doing DoD, you mentioned the 5 layers, and I was just wondering whether that was a slip of the tongue. You did actually mean 4.
That was probably before I picked up my TCP/IP study guide book to look at myself.
before you learned this subject.
No, it's weird because some of these layers, you might be doing some internet searching, and some people say, well, host-to-host layer, that's the transport layer.
Okay.
You know, but I'm just going with what I was taught from the Novell exams, I think. And the internet layer, some people call it the routing layer, and some people call it the TCP/IP model, and the TCP/IP model's got 5 layers rather than 4.
Okay.
So it's a little bit weird, but the DoD model certainly has these 4 layers, and it's a 4-layered model.
And that's what the book says, and that's what the book says,
and that's what we'll be able to see in Network Monitor. Okay. So what I want to show you is show you the point of these models and show you the implementation of the models by looking at Network Monitor.
So we're going to see a real world.
Exactly, and that's just something you can't do with the OSI model.
No.
Now, mapping DoD to OSI. The DoD model, because you can see it, it's going to be a lot easier to remember and understand.
Yeah.
And what I remember, and this got me through my CCNA exams, is how they map to each other. And again, there is a slight bit of debate upon the exact mapping of the layers to each layer, but I normally go with this 3-1-1-2. And that's the first 3 layers of the OSI map to the first layer of the DoD. The next one, which is transport, maps to host to host. The next one, network, which is internet. And the next 2, data link, goes to network access. Does that sort of make sense?
With 3-1-1-2.
Yeah.
I was going to say, because which ones have we just decided to leave out? Did the Department of Defense just leave out? But obviously they didn't.
I think what they do sometimes is the routing component, they split up a little bit.
Sure, makes sense.
And when you look at the mapping, it's not quite as clean as that. It's like 3.5.
Okay.
The first layers, but I mean that will do the job.
So you've got
certainly a
bit of overlap, but
yeah. But if all you're looking for is understanding, and they'll help you troubleshoot and get you through your CCNA or whatever.
If all you're looking to do is pass an exam, just 3-1-1-2.
3-1-1-2,
and don't lose any sleep.
That's the one.
Okay.
Right. Can I do it? Where's my notepad? Right. So we've done OSI versus DoD. We've done the layers of the DoD. What's on what layer? Which layer? Okay, what? It's preparation, that
it's
is.
It's professional and everything.
I'm not going to use this drawing pad, I don't think.
No?
Because it's going to take too long. What I want to do is just give you guys a rough idea what you will find on each layer, together with a definition on of each one of them.
Yeah.
So the process application layer, we'll see IE, our internet, our browser, or obviously Mozilla, your Firefox, or whatever you want. So on the other side of things, you also see your web server. So I'm going to put IIS in there as well. But it could be anything. It could be email, SMTP.
I was going to say, yeah.
All applications.
FTP, anything.
FTP. I mean, what are we using to remote control our machines back there? RDP is another one. Okay, so remote desktop protocol. And they're all applications designed for TCP/IP. Now, the benefits of this, whoever wrote Internet Explorer, they're not worried at all about any layer other than the host-to-host layer. So they're not worried about how it routes. They're not worried about going over Ethernet. They're not worried about going over the token ring. And that's why, you know, you're running Internet Explorer, it works exactly the same way, whether you're dial-up, whether you're VPNing, whether you're going over token ring, or whatever. It works exactly the same, or it might be a bit slower. But that's some of the benefits. The next layer down deals with the connection type we're going to make between source and destination. Now, there's two connection types we've gotten on the Internet or on a TCP/IP network. There's connectionless and connection-orientated.
Right, okay. And the difference being?
One is connectionless, and one has a connection.
No. Is it as in when would you use one or t'other?
No, it's a good question. So I'm just going to define those protocols here and put TCP and UDP.
Okay.
Because TCP is your connection-orientated protocol, and UDP is your connectionless.
Okay.
And it just asked when would you use each one. Now, in actual fact, it's not really our decision. It's the person who made the application, they decide who they're going to fund it off to. You know, so people writing into Explorer, they say, well, you know, we're using HTTP, and HTTP as a protocol is designed to use TCP.
Yeah.
So Internet Explorer will talk down to the TCP/IP part of the host-to-host layer.
Okay.
Other things, for example, I can't think of any moment, video broadcasting, you know, audio broadcasting, will go down to and use UDP. It's connectionless. Okay. So TCP is connection-orientated, UDP is connectionless. Now, when you're web browsing, everything's done in TCP. You're generating a connection to the web server, so you've got this little three-way handshake going on. You generated a connection, it's nice and secure, and then we can communicate across that connection.
Yep.
Okay, and we're all saying, did you get that, blah. And they say yes. Now, there's some nice analogies we can use to this. It's like, if I want to talk to Nick using TCP, it's like me phoning him up. So I can phone him up, we generate the connection, and then over that connection we can start talking, and I can say, did you hear that, Nick, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So that's TCP. The other thing is UDP, which stands for User Datagram Protocol. Now, this is connectionless, and to use an analogy...
It's more of a broadcast. Then.
It's a broadcast, yeah. Well, broadcast will use UDP, but if I want to talk to Nick and I'm using UDP, I suppose a good analogy for this would be... See that... I pretend I don't know it. I suppose I'm thinking off the top of my head. I haven't done this 3,000 times before. I suppose, what would be a good one? I know, writing a postcard.
Popping
it in the post. So I wrote Nick's address on it in Ashford and pop it in the post. And if the postman is brave enough to deliver it to Ashford, he eventually gets there. But I don't know.
Why didn't you just bring it with you today then? Instead of putting it in the post.
Well, I don't know. Shut up. I don't know whether it's got there or not. Okay. Where I phoned him, I know he listened to me, where I've sent him a postcard, I haven't got a clue. Okay, so things that use UDP, broadcasting, you know, video streaming, it doesn't matter if I lose a frame or not.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, who cares? But if you imagine if you're web browsing and you lose a frame, you might get some page corruption. Certainly if you're using FTP,
yeah.
You know, you're downloading a large file from the other side of the internet, if you lose one frame, that's it, you're knackered. So, leading on from that, it's sort of obvious, FTP... uses TCP.
TCP, yeah.
Now, there is actually a different version of FTP. You Cisco guys are now TFTP, which is Trivial File Transfer Protocol.
Okay.
And that uses UDP. Right, next off. Next layer down, the Internet layer. Now, there's quite a few other things on this layer. The main thing on this layer is the IP.
Internet Protocol.
Internet Protocol, which all deals with routing, how we get from source to destination. And we're... Again, when I show you Network Monitor, it'll be easy to see the IP layer in there. But some of the other things we've got in there are ARP, ICMP. Heard of ICMP, Nat? ICMP is Internet Control Messaging Protocol. I guess some of you, the most widely used thing that you probably use that uses ICMP is ping.
Ah, okay.
Okay, so it's generally used between routers. One of my interfaces down, let's send an ICMP message back, or, you know, you're sending me stuff to... too quickly, I send an ICMP.
Slow down.
Source quench, yeah.
Okay.
Source quench like that. So that's ICMP, and it's, I see it as the Internet Recovery Protocol. So it's almost like an error and recovery protocol in there. So it's interesting that, but ping is not actually an application. It doesn't sit up there with IE, IIS, SMTP.
Okay.
And lots of people say it's an application. Even some books say it's an application.
And they're wrong.
They're wrong, yeah. And we can prove that, because what I do is we ping someone and I show you network monitor. And what you'll notice is there won't be a process application layer in any of those. And network access is your sort of... your network card lives down on here, so I'm going to say, Nick, your NIC card lives here. So your NIC card driver, it's got the packet, it's correctly formed, we know what type of connection we're going to generate, we know the next hop, or the next router, and the next thing we need to do is come on the MAC address.
Yeah.
Okay, so the MAC address really ought to define that one as well. When we go to a website, you type in the name, which gets resolved to an IP address, but the IP address doesn't actually physically belong to that machine. It's all done in software.
Yeah.
The only thing physical about that machine is the physical address.
The binding on the MAC address.
Which is the MAC address, yeah. The media access control, nothing to do with Apple Macs. Okay, it's the MAC address. So every machine has got an IP address and a MAC address. And I can quickly show you that. If I go into, oops, if I go into a command prompt and type ipconfig, that's my software address, 192.168.1.102. If I do an ipconfig /all on here, we can see
physical
the MAC
address,
the physical address there. Mm. So ultimately...
I mean, otherwise you wouldn't be able to have a local network here. Otherwise the packet's going out, or everything's going out on one IP address. How would it know how to... that it was your machine that generated
exactly,
that request?
Exactly, yeah. So the MAC address is unique to every machine. Every single network card in the world has got a different MAC address. And if it hasn't, you've got a faulty batch. Which do exist, you get from vendors, because it's burnt into the ROM.
Sure, yeah.
It's burnt into the ROM, and that can cause loads of fun.
I was going to say, that must cause hideous amount of problems.
Yeah, I mean, you can get MAC address conflicts, and lots of devices like your routers, you can change the MAC address so it clashes with this. And there are some hacking reasons why you wouldn't want to do that.
Okay.
Or why people do that, why you want to do that. Okay, so the way this all works, and I am going to use this pad now, I think. So this might be a bit painful, guys. And girl. Do you know that girl who posted?
Oh, yeah.
Soufey's sister.
Does she actually watch it, though?
Well, she watched the Soufey one. I doubt she watches anything else.
Oh, right. So she's not a genuine girl one. She's not like a... She's not in IT, though.
No, she's not in IT. No, I don't know what she does. I think she does something.
What is that? Is that like a pillow?
That's... This is the DoD model, and it's...
Ah, I see. I wondered what you were drawing.
Okay, so I'm going to put P for process application, hard to handle, host to host, internet. Oh, I'll put this down.
You were doing it so nicely in your test ones earlier on.
Network. I know, but I feel rushed now.
Why? No, take your time.
Because people are downloading this crap. Right, so up on there we said your web browser, didn't we?
Yeah.
So you want to go to Google, so you type in the web browser, www.google.co.uk. And what will happen is the application will send out what it does to the next layer, and that would be an HTTP GET command. Now, you guys, you probably know HTTP GET, being a developer. And this is good stuff, because I know lots of people have been asking about ISA.
Okay.
And we will do ISA, but I need to spend some time so I can do a relatively good job, because I don't do ISA as part of my work normally. You know. So but I would like to get a bit more involved in that. No, I just do a help desk, you know, resetting passwords.
I was going to say.
That kind of thing. It's very familiar.
He's hoping to move up from that eventually.
Yeah. Right, so we can see there's an HTTP GET in there.
God, my
and that just moves
live
down.
Around that.
No one's going to be able to read that, I think, but you're going to have to follow through with listening.
Have you not got a document that goes, a nice drawing that goes with it?
Not right. Like this, no.
Okay,
so that goes down to the next layer. And the next layer, it just sees that as data. It doesn't care what's in it. All it's going to do is carry it.
Mm.
So it's like a wrapper. And onto this, we're going to have a TCP header, because TCP lives in this layer. Where's the mouse? Where's the mouse? No. TCP. So what you're seeing there is you'll see the source port and the destination port. I'm going to a web browser. A web browser to a web server. The destination port will be?
The router.
No, destination port.
I have no idea then.
80.
Oh, port 80. Yeah.
Not the router so much at the moment, because we're not worried about that, and that's the next layer down. Okay, we'd worry about how we're going to connect to it. So that moves down to the next layer, which all of that's seen as just data. Again, so the TCP header and the actual HTTP get are just seen as data to the next layer. On that, you will see source IP. I'm just going to speak this, source IP and destination IP, so SIP and DIP. Okay, so source IP address and destination IP address, and that's just data. Moving on quickly to the next one. And on the next one, that's all seen as data. And, oh no, don't crash.
I know, what have you done?
Your pen's crap then. And the next one is the MAC address. Okay, you're going to probably need to see this in Network Monitor. So the addressing information on that, you'll see the hardware address of source and destination, the next hop we're trying to get to.
Seems fine to me.
Right. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to load up Network Monitor. Now, Network Monitor, this tool, it's part of Windows Server, so yeah. Anyone can just add this. I think it's seen as network and monitoring tools in app remove components. If you've got SMS, you've got the full version of Network Monitor. Mm-hmm. And the differences are, the full version of Network Monitor will be able to pick up and will pick up and show you anything that it can hear, that this machine can actually hear, okay, whether it's addressed to it or not.
Okay, so any packet that's travelling
through it. Anything that goes through the cable, if we're on a cable network, it will actually pick up and show. Now, regardless of the destination MAC address, now in order to do that, your network card needs to operate in something called promiscuous mode.
Right.
Okay, because in effect it's grabbing things off the network which really aren't for it. Now, when you think about it, most networks are switched now, so it's unlikely that this machine will actually hear of anything that isn't directly related to it anyway.
Okay.
Because the switch, well, that's kind of interesting, that's sort of OSI based as well.
Right.
The switch, I've got that diagram.
Yeah, because that was actually in the original diagram, wasn't it?
It was. I think I've got a nicer diagram in here. Well, the switch sort of operates down on, in DoD it's network interface, but in OSI it's data link. And some of you guys, switches are often referred to as layer 2 routers.
Okay.
And IP routers, what most people think of routers, are layer 3 routers, which is network, which ties up to DoD. What's that layer? IP. So that's your IP routing. So Network Monitor. Now you can use any protocol analyzer. I'm just using it because it's one I've got hold of at the Mo. But we're not using any specific features of this. Ethereal, I believe, is a free one. Or a shareware one, you can get Ethereal. And I'm just going to start off this capture and see what it can hear. Whilst I do this, let's just fire up Internet Explorer, generate some network traffic.
So this is only stuff that's going via this machine. So ideally you'd want this sitting on your server.
Yeah.
excuse me.
Now, often on switches, there's often a port or a port you can configure which floods all the traffic through that port anyway.
Okay, yeah.
And that you could put your monitoring machine on. Right, so we've done a little bit of capture. Let's just stop this for a second. Now, just to examine this, we can see over on this side, and we have done a little bit of this before, we can see the MAC addresses of machines and what they've communicated with. So I can see this one here, this MAC address. What is it at the end? BBB. What's my MAC address? Not me. So that isn't me. So how come I picked it up? Well, it sent information to this machine here. All Fs.
Yeah.
What do you reckon that is?
Is that some sort of dummy thing?
It's actually a broadcast.
Oh, okay.
It's just like IP. When the host bits are set to all one, that's seen as a broadcast.
Okay.
This is a MAC address, but that's effectively set to all one. They're all full.
Okay.
If you convert that into binary. So that did a broadcast. This machine talked 99 frames to this machine, C95.
That is you.
Which is me, and I sent 92 back. We can see I did a broadcast. And not quite sure what that one is. Oh, maybe I am so that might be the exchange server. So maybe I'm picking up all the traffic in here. So I'm not sure if this is seen as a switch network or not, because we're running VMware, which is bridged through a wireless network, and it's really actually hard to see what's
yeah,
going on.
Yeah, sure.
But those two machines, I'm not in there, am I?
I'm
C95. Yes, I am. Okay. Right, so let's actually view this information. Right, so first off, I loaded up Internet Explorer. And Internet Explorer... Well, actually, before we do that, let's look at the different levels.
Oh, so yeah, okay.
I can see this is the process application layer. That's right. The internet layer. That's the... No, it's not.
No, that's not.
People are host-to-host, internet, network access. Okay, gotcha. People are hard-to-handle or network in new activities.
Yeah.
Okay, so DNS. This is all the applications sent out, and it's quite interesting. We can see here, we can see the DS query. We can see... I'm looking for the... Oh, there it is there.
The good stuff.
There you go. So go.microsoft.com.
Yeah.
And that's because that's the homepage, I think, by default.
Okay, so that was just you firing up your browser.
That's me just firing up the browser, yeah. So I asked this machine, and that's the DNS server, what is Microsoft.com? Now, I'm not interested in that traffic because that wasn't me. But the next off is, for some reason... Oh, this is a reply to me, actually, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's a reply, and that's the response for go.microsoft.com. And again, we just open this out. Oh, this display's okay. And we can see answer to the question, go.microsoft.com. Expand that out.
Yeah, so now if we...
Oh, the answer section's in there.
There we go. So that was, yeah, it was doing a lookup.
Oh, it's using a canonical name, so it's a CNAME record, and...
So it's going and doing a lookup, wasn't it?
Yeah, and it's actually going to look up go.microsoft.akadns.net, and this is the query for that.
Yep, and it comes back with an IP address.
And then we've got the IP address. So that's kind of interesting. We can see a CNAME is an alias record, so they're hiding go.microsoft.com. That's not the real machine name, it's actually go.microsoft.akadns.net.
So this covers like some of the, you know, when we were doing some of our stuff with the DNS and things like this, and we were talking about it going and doing a lookup.
Exactly, yeah.
And this is exactly what we've seen it go and do, isn't it?
Yeah. So this is all in the application layer, and that's all that the DNS client and the DNS server has to worry about.
Yeah.
Don't have to worry about the connection. Don't have to worry about how it gets there. That's all done at lower levels. There's so many analogies you can make to these little levels, and one of them is a post from one. So if you ask your secretary to go and communicate with someone and order you some more boxes for your factory.
Right.
So you can pack some more biscuits and stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, do you care how they do it? You probably phone up your PA.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have a PA. So you phone up your PA stroke wife and you say, you say, oi, order me some boxes. And that's it. Nick's happy. He's happy now because he's passed it off to the lower level.
Yeah.
The lower level is going to either... You know, send it by mail, phone up, etc. But you get the results back again.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's it. Right, next off, let's go down a little layer here. We can see that DNS actually uses UDP as a transport. Okay, so it's connectionless. Now, DNS actually uses two ports. It uses UDP for lookups. It uses TCP for communicating between DNS servers, doing zone transfers.
Right.
So in here, I can see that destination port is 0x0401 and the source port is DNS. Now, Network Monitor is actually doing something a bit nice for me here. It's instead of displaying the port name, it's telling me what, instead of the port number, it's telling me what that port number is typically associated with.
Oh, so it's just it's giving you more information.
Yeah, it's just put DNS in there. I think it's 53.
Oh, so it's doing its own lookup on certain types of ports just to give you
It must be internal description to this application, yeah. It's something that this app's doing. Okay, so we can see the sources, so I know that's from the DNS server. Okay, so I've got the IP address of that. Now, the next thing I need to do is I've got the IP address, and going back to IP communication, the next thing you do is you work out that IP address I'm trying to get to, is it local or is it remote? Okay, is it local to me or is it remote to me?
So...
And we can do that by taking our subnet mask, scanning it, to finding out what network it's on. But pretty obviously, go.microsoft.com is not actually on your network, Nick. It's actually remote.
I didn't want to say anything there. I'm actually hosting it on their behalf here.
So what the client machine has got to do now is it's got to forward that information to the next hop, which would be the default gateway.
Yeah.
So let's have a look at what the next traffic is. Oh, it's us again. And we're saying, I want to get the... or it's an ARP message, which is Address Resolution Protocol.
Yeah.
And what ARP does, it translates a software address into a hardware address, i.e. an IP address into a MAC address. So we know the default gateway, or, well, I'm telling you, the default gateway is 192.168.1.1. And this is my machine just shouting out, look who it's sending it to, all X.
Everybody.
Yeah, if you've got this IP address, can you reply to me with your MAC address?
Okay, so that's my router then coming back and saying...
Exactly, your router. Now have a look at where ARP is. Okay, on top of the Ethernet, ARP. Let's go back to our little diagram. Oh no, I got rid of it, didn't I?
No, you didn't. Keep going. No, keep going left again.
Oh no, this is the one I wanted. This will do. So we can see that ARP lives on that layer there.
Yeah.
You're okay with that? Does that make sense?
That does. It makes perfect sense.
So we can see ARP, and there's no host to host, there's no process application, it's all done a bit lower down. So we've ARPed out for that, and we can have a look at the communication there. And I just say my sender address, my sender protocol, which is my software address, the target address, which is nothing, because I don't know what the target hardware address is as yet, but I fill out the target software address, which is 192.168.1.1. If you have a look at the next one, it's a response. Whoops. And we can see that information has now been filled out
on the response.
So I found the MAC address, and the next thing I'm going to do is communicate with that MAC address. So we can see ARPing and everything.
Excellent.
So that's kind of cool.
So, a couple of quick questions. I mean, obviously, this has been around for a very long time. I mean, the OSI model for... Uh-huh. I don't know, what, 20, 30 years?
We did it at university, so it is a long time.
Well, that's a long time ago. And I take it there must be slight... Things must be quite slow to evolve and move on and change, because obviously you've got pretty much everything based on these foundations.
Yeah, and that's what they are. They're basically foundations. I mean, it is possible to have a different connection type. For example, we've talked about TCP and UDP.
Yeah.
It's actually another one called... It's rather confusingly RDP, which is not Remote Desktop Protocol, but it's Reliable Datagram Protocol.
Okay.
And this is similar, using an analogy
to... And this is a new one, is it?
It's not new. It's been around for a little while, but it's not... I think only a few applications make use of it. It's like sending something recorded delivery. Pop it a postcard and I get a response back to say it got there.
Okay.
So that's a sort of analogy for that.
Oh, okay.
Right, so that's looking at ARP and ROP. Right, I'm going to have a look at... What's up? 57, oh yeah. You're saying we're running out of time now?
No, I was just bringing time to your attention, because you said you didn't want to witter on.
That's ARP-RAP.
ARP-RAP.
ARP-RAP. I'm going to remind myself of this diagram and see if I can show you anything else.
Can you show me the internet?
The internet? There you go.
Oh, okay, excellent. Thanks.
Is that better for you? Right, I'm going to just do another little capture just to show you some fun things you can do in Network Monitor. This is all good stuff now, because you know the source port, you know how the source port works, you know about the application or the application frame at the top, because this is what ISA works on. Now ISA will target and have a look at the port that you're trying to get to and say, no, you're not doing that, mate. Okay, so they actually filter at various different
levels.
At the
packet level.
Yeah, so they're filtering down. Well, they can filter at different levels. They can filter on the IP address as well and say, no, I'm not letting that source address in here, or I'm not letting, you know, you get to source port 80, because I don't want you getting to my internal web server. But unfortunately for that, everything goes by port 80 now.
Yeah.
You know, people access SharePoint through port 80, you know, your Exchange through port 80. So you need some kind of way of protecting your network a bit better than just scanning for the ports. We want to actually look inside and say, okay, you're coming to port 80, that may be okay, but I'm more interested in what you're going to do.
Once you're...
So how do you think ISA deals with that? It actually scans the application packet.
Yeah.
Okay, so ISA is seen as an application filter, and that's why you notice when you're running on your small master server. It did have a bit of an impact, didn't it?
Man, the thing just ground to a complete halt.
Yeah, so we don't want security at your company, do we? So we just switched it off.
Yeah.
Well, the thing is, Nick, you're behind a hardware firewall anyway, aren't you?
I am, yeah.
And I'm
not really exposing...
You're not exposed now, and you've got NAT as well behind that.
Yeah.
So I think you're well protected. Or
for what I expose anyway.
Okay, so that's looking at DoD. I'm just going to have a look at this. Network Monitor, ARP, comma. That's as far as I got.
quality.
Internet quality, yeah, I think that's it. I'm happy.
Excellent.
I'm happy. Yeah. Okay, yeah, so a bit of a short one, but we just had to get one out for Monday, didn't we? But I think it's good.
It's 35 minutes.
It's definitely a build-up one, because we'll come back to this and say and show ISA and do some network monitoring.
Will that be in next week's episode?
Don't give me any hassle. Well, next week's episode, we're actually going to film in 5 minutes' time.
That's what that means.
So probably not. No, I just need to get my ass into gear. I've got some guys who are still interested in doing storage over networks.
Yeah, that's a big one.
Yeah,
we almost need to nick some stuff off my dad, you know, to do all this.
Yeah.
I think maybe we just need to go and raid his hardware closet, and then obviously we can put some software solutions. Because I think it's the software solutions around the hardware that people are interested in.
Yeah, there's that. It's hard to tell, because I think we've got quite a mixed audience. I think some of them are interested in a bit more techie stuff and some a bit more fun stuff. But we'll do storage area networks. I don't want to do a techie one on that one, because I haven't told you this, but from work we can use their machines. We can turn it into their machines. And
to do what?
Use storage area networks.
Oh, okay. So they'll let us do all that.
Yeah.
Excellent. So we can set up our SANs and then back up all of
our website must get hit about 30 times more than theirs. Do you know what I mean?
Really?
So if we can give them any business. Yeah, if you want to, any kind of networking you've got, if you're in the London area, Eurodata, eurodatasystems.com, we're really, really good. Mention my name and I'm sure we can work out 1% discount.
Half a percent discount and then half.
Oh yeah, we get half.
We're going to take our fee.
We get 10 really.
Ah, okay.
No, eurodatasystems.com, say you watch the podcast, let's see if anything happens. Okay. I finished.
Right.
You happy?
Excellent.
How do we normally wrap this up?
I normally thank you for doing such a great job.
Thank you.
So this week I'll thank you for doing a mediocre job.
Not so bad.
So I think what I will say to people is we do seem to be getting people now that are watching our episodes through our website. So they've obviously just found us.
Mm-hmm.
And people are asking questions like, well, how do I get hold of, can I download them and things like this, which obviously to us seems a bit alien, but
yeah, well, I think
just find it. Click on the XML link, go to iTunes, you can subscribe to us through iTunes. Obviously, those who don't know about our website, come along to the forums, which is itidiots.com. But yeah, you can download them by just clicking on the XML link and then choosing the episode you want in H.264 or in glorious MP4. I think that really covers all the technical stuff. So until next week, I'm going to say goodbye and see you later.
See ya.
Bye.
Bye.
He cried himself to sleep tonight on his huge pillow.